wonderful mission trip for the day yesterday up to Mechanicsburg. 8 of us went up. And Kenny, yes?
Yeah, my niece is home.
Okay, so your niece is home after being in the hospital. Wonderful.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Away. One step away.
Gracious God, we do give you thanks and praise for this time to come and to give thanks. We thank you, O God, for the blessings that you have poured down upon us this day, this week, and throughout our days. We thank you, O God, that you made all creation and called it good, that you have lavished your creatures with beauty and sustained us with your grace. And so, O God, we pray that you would move and work in us and throughout creation. Draw us closer to you and closer to one another, that we may indeed hear your word and be empowered to act upon it. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite the young ones to come up front. It is time for our children's message. And if you would like, you may go downstairs with Miss Alyssa into the nursery during the sermon part. Or you can go back to your families. Either way, everyone will be back here. It's time for communion. What a good looking crowd we have. All right. We're missing one more. Well, maybe that person's not going to go. Did you see the person? Who you were thinking of? Yeah? Okay. Oh, okay. So, I have a question for everybody. What are some things that help you if you get sad or angry or upset? What are some things that you do that help?
I'm being sad.
You're being sad? Yeah? What do you do? Pull your hair. That sounds unfun. Does that help? Oh, your hair is too short to pull. Yeah? Yeah? So sometimes when we're really little, we might like suck our thumb or use a pacifier if we're upset, right? Or we might snuggle into a blanket. Or we might go snuggle someone who loves us, right? Sometimes that's helpful. Sometimes horsing around cheers us up, doesn't it? Oh, wrestling each other, we'll say. Yeah, get our mind off of things. Well, one of the things that I find really important when I'm really upset is to be able to go to God in prayer, because I know that God will hear me and that God will work in my heart when I am feeling that way and work in me the way I need to be worked in. So, are you guys ready to pray together? Okay. Gracious God, we thank you that you love us at the moment just as we are. We thank you for your comfort when we are upset, or scared, or angry. We thank you, O God, that you are always present to us with the power of prayer, assuring us of love and mercy and grace. Amen. All right, so we have lollipops for everyone who lines up quietly and takes turns.
Not open the lollipop until you get down to the nurse.
Yes, the lollipop has to stay closed until you're done walking, okay? So pick your favorite flavor, and then keep the wrapper on it until you get downstairs. And Miss Alyssa is standing in the back waiting for anybody who wants to go downstairs for the sermon. Oh, you're so great. That's my favorite.
It is very important.
You want, hey, I'm gonna leave these with your mommy, okay? She usually likes to hang out.
Yeah.
And she is amazing. Thank you. Very much. Right. And so today I'm going to focus this on the Gospel of Luke. So I'm going to lead us right into the Gospel lesson. And we're in Luke 12, verses 13 to 21. A little bit of background as we move into that reading. Jesus has been spending time teaching on hypocrisy, fear, worry, and facing opposition. And apparently one of his hearers was not listening very well because he interrupts with this question. So we're going to begin with this interruption where we read. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Friend, who set me to be judge and arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid out for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasure for themselves, but are not rich toward God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And so apparently, this person in the crowd wasn't paying deep attention to what Jesus was saying. He interrupted with a question basically entirely focused on himself and worried about an inheritance fight that was going on between he and his brother. Whenever I read the scripture, I think about how surprising it was to me. One of the things that I learned in becoming a pastor in my early years was how different families are, right, from my own. Now, of course, older and wiser, most of us know this by now. But I was particularly blown away by the families that I encountered who would tear themselves apart over inheritances. And I had seen this more than once in my first few years. And I remember being home for Christmas at my mom's and just talking about life. And I commented, you know, of course, nobody's family is perfect. Mine certainly isn't, but we're all different. And I just remember commenting, like, gosh, I'm amazed at people who will surrender their relationship with a sibling or a cousin or whatever over an inheritance. It just boggles my mind. And yet, it's apparently an age-old problem, right? So much so that this man is going to interrupt Jesus' teaching of the kingdom of God to ask for some arbitration here. And so, Jesus goes into a parable, as he so often does, in order to answer a question. And it is the parable of the rich man. Basically, this man is what we would call a practical atheist, which is to say he may believe in God at some head level, but when it comes to taking action, the actions don't reflect what the teachings of faith are. And so in practical terms, when this man is presented with this abundance, right, which, of course, we say we believe comes from God, that everything that we have and all that we are comes from God, and he gets this bumper crop, and his attention doesn't turn to compassion or generosity or thoughts of who he might be able to bless with this abundance that God has given him. Instead, it turns to, well, how am I going to hold on to more of this stuff, right? His focus isn't on the kingdom of God. His focus isn't on living the faith. His focus is on himself and the false teaching of the world, that if he can lay up more treasure, well, then he can eat, drink, and be merry, which is apparently what he thinks the good life is, right? And of course, Jesus spends the most amount of time talking about the kingdom of God and the danger of riches. Those are his top two topics of teaching and conversation for throughout the Gospels. And Jesus' followers in the early days and in the early days of the church were predominantly poor people. I mean, these were not people who had the problem with this rich man, okay? And yet Jesus teaches on this often. And the reason for that, of course, is that one does not have to have any money in order to be enamored by wanting lots more of it, right? Or striving after it as a focus. Or one does not have to be rich to believe that eating, drinking, and hanging out is the purpose of life. But this practical atheist, if you will, has come to that place, has come to a place of believing that that must be what the good life looks like. It reminded me of one of my favorite quotes, or favorite excerpts, I should say, from C.S. Lewis. C.S. Lewis was he was not a pastor or an ordained person. He was a writer and an author and a radio show host, actually, in the early part of the last century. And he wrote this, and it's a bit long, so hang in with me. I think it's my favorite thing he's ever written. The ordinary idea, which we all have before we become Christians, is this. We take as our starting point our ordinary self with its various desires and interests. We then admit that something else, call it morality or decent behavior or the good of society, has a claim on this self, claims which interfere with its own desires. What we mean by being good is giving into those claims. Some of the things the ordinary self wanted to do turn out to be what we call wrong. Well, we must give those up. Other things turn out to be what we call right. Well, we shall have to do those. But we are hoping all the time that when the demands have been met, the poor natural self will still have some chance and some time to get on with its own life, to do what it likes. In fact, we are very like an honest person paying taxes. The person pays them all right, but does so hoping that there will be enough left over for them to live on, because we are still taking the natural self as the starting point. As long as we are thinking that one way or the other, one of two things will result. Either we give up trying to be good, or we become very unhappy indeed, for make no mistake, if you are really going to try to meet all the demands of the natural self, which is thus being starved and hampered and worried at every turn, you will get angrier and angrier. In the end, you will either give up trying to be good, or else become one of those people who, as they say, lives for others, but always in a discontented and grumbling way. The Christian way is different, hard, and easier. Christ says, give me all. I don't want so much of your time and so much of your money and so much of your work. I want you. I have not come to torment your natural self. I have come to kill it. No half measures are any good. I don't want to cut off a branch here and a branch there. I want to have the whole tree down. Hand over the whole natural self and the desires which you think innocent as well as the ones you think wicked. The whole outfit. I will give you a new self instead. In fact, I will give you my self. My own shall become yours. Both harder and easier than what we are trying to do. And so the question that this scripture and C.S. Lewis lays before us this week is, how are we giving our whole selves over to Christ? Are we being practical atheists like the rich man? When push comes to shove, we spend more time worrying about how we'll store our excess. Or are we focused upon living according to the way the kingdom would have us to live? I had lunch this week with Carlos Reyes, our deacon, and Megan Chitama, a friend and colleague who's also chair of the Board of Ordained Ministry. We all graduated from the same seminary in Washington, D.C. And our reason for meeting was recruitment. And enrollment at the seminary is down, not surprising, given the nature of things in the United Methodist Church right now with LGBTQ debates, etc. And as often happens when I get together with my friends, and then we went from complaining about how difficult that was to thinking about issues of racism, and you know, round and round we went, and finally the conversation got so depressing, I said, God, I'm just tired thinking about all of it, you know, just tired. And so then I felt one of those little promptings of the Holy Spirit, in which I was reminded that looking over the scope of history, whenever wonderful, momentous, important change happens, always God is in the midst of it. There is always a spiritual component to anything important and meaningful that takes place for good in the world. And then on Friday night, I got to have a conversation with a woman who was here to give a presentation. She does advocacy work all over the country, and she mentioned that this week she was going to go down to the border. And she does a lot around immigration and the border issues that are happening. And my knee-jerk reaction was to say, well, that's exciting. You know, we get to travel. And she sighed heavily, and she said, do you have children? And I said, yeah, I have two. And she said, I have three, younger than mine. And she said, it's really hard to see his children. And then on Saturday, we went to our mission trip, which was awesome. And then Ray and I dragged ourselves to Planet Fitness to work out, and we walked in, and across all of the television screens were news about the shootings. And as I was sitting on my exercise bike, still thinking about Sunday's sermon, as I always am on Saturday night, and thinking about all of the things in the world that just make me sad, tired, and weary. And I thought about these words from C.S. Lewis. So really, I have a choice. We have a choice. One is practical atheism, to focus on eating and drinking and being merry as much as I can, and hope that that somehow numbs out whatever is going on. Going and sitting on the beach in Barcelona again sounds quite lovely to me sometimes. Or I can trust that God is working in me to build up a new house, to build up a new self, and that the calling of God upon my life, upon our lives, is not only to cry with those who cry and to mourn with those who mourn, but also to rejoice with those who rejoice. To trust that in the walking of this walk, in this living the life of faith, in being faithful to the call of God to show love, to advocate for justice, to care for people in need, that this is the path of abundant life. That this is the path where even in the midst of all of this trouble, that God is present and able and active and bringing us abundant life as we journey together through it. Jürgen Moltmann, one of my favorite theologians, it's not a fabulous name, Jürgen, it's a German name, and he was a soldier in the German army in World War II, and that led him into his theological work. And one of the things that he writes is that it is our longing for something better. It is our gut reaction that this can't be all there is. This can't be how the world is intended to be. That points us to the truth that there is something more. Because if there were nothing else, we would simply accept the world as it is. But all of us have within us those rebellious spots when we see the news of 20 people dead in Texas. When we see the news of children locked up on the border of our country, we know deep within us, in that God shaped space inside, but that's not God intends for creation. And sometimes I really dream about just turning off the TV and shutting it all out and flying far, far away. But the good news is that God is not done with us yet. That God is at work in the midst of all of the messiness, of all of the pain, of all of the trial, working in our lives to redeem and heal us, and inviting us to go into our communities, our neighborhoods, our state legislatures, wherever it is, to advocate for the kingdom of God, to bear witness for what God is able to do. At the middle service, we sang a hymn. It was written in the 1500s called Now Thank We All Our God. And we usually sing that around Thanksgiving time, just because it's got that word thank in it, but good hymn all year round. And it was written by a pastor named Martin Rieger. here. When the plague hit, he did literally hundreds of funerals, so many he lost count of them, including his wife. And it was that year that he wrote Now Thank We All Our God. It was that year that he wrote that. And that is the hope of God at work. That is where I want to live. I want to live in such a way as to be open to the truth that God is still active and alive and working and leading us in new and wonderful ways, even as the world seems to be falling down around us, because that's the truth. And so I invite you to reflect on how it is that you open yourself up to God working in and through you. How do you allow God to build up God's own self within you? How do you participate in the kingdom of God? Amen.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right to do joyfully always.
here, and then